myself humming along with the engine the same way I do in my own cars, the inline six cars, and in a way that I don't do in most modern cars. And I think that has a lot to do with Mazda's Skyactiv approach, the transmission snapping off shifts, the naturally aspirated motor, the fact that you can hear it doing its work. There's a lot of feedback from this car. Progressive controls, something we've forgotten about in the day of turbocharging especially. Those progressive controls that make it so delightful in these twisties make it a car that flatters even a casual driver or perhaps a slightly inept one. Sounds a lot like Miata, doesn't it? Which makes me wonder, what is this company going to be capable of when they have a rear drive platform to build their everyday cars off of, like they've done with the MX-5 all along? So you stay in it, and it gives you a downshift, gives you a little bit of stability intervention, but doesn't shut things down. When Mazda says, when Dave Coleman tells me that we don't want the stability control to get in the way of the driver, and that I should take a CX-5 up into the hills, well, Dave, thanks for the advice. I'm glad I did it, and I'm glad I chose this over everything else in the rental car stand. You can kind of see where that G vectoring control came from as well. When you're off the throttle in these cars, on turn-in, it's a good thing, but then it turns into understeer, so you want to get off throttle, then back on throttle. And that's something that the G vectoring control does for you. It's a baked-in trait and kind of a hack to getting the most out of these chassis. Yeah, off throttle, understeer for the afraid. Hear that? There it is. When you get back on, it goes quiet. So you want to transfer that weight to that back axle. Right there on the edge of adhesion. That's nice. I have to say, I'm not missing having paddles on the steering wheel. I think we've kind of fallen for a trend on that front. Like having a shifter down here where shifters have always been. I don't get confused by where the paddle is. That's just me. What a great car. That's all transmission and sport program. You'll notice I haven't been reaching for gears. It's just the transmission doing its thing. That'll downshift again. Yep, right when I would have downshifted, it downshifts. Thought I'd be using the manual mode a lot more just because it is set up and does cater to manual transmission driving. But as you can hear, I'm just kind of leaving it. And that's not even in sport mode. That's just standard drive mode. But if I put it in sport, even more so. Hangs on to the revs. All alone up here. Sit down to the icy patches. I can hear that. It's just, this is how you would select gears yourself. And if it isn't, oh, beautiful. Downshift under braking, even as I was backing out the brakes. In a way, you might say that the same thing that makes a 911 more engaging than a Cayman makes driving something like this more engaging than, let's say, a last generation 3 on 18s. Mazda's come under a lot of fire for the way they've evolved their recipe. It's a bit of the old Coke, new Coke dilemma, but one thing's for sure, the way that the cars are now set up, it's easier to cover long distances in them. And at the same time, when you start to work the car harder, it feels alive. God, I can't believe I just used that. But it actually does feel alive at a lower speed range than you might get if the Mazda had continued to go for higher and higher and higher limits, higher and higher and higher speeds. And in a way, that sets them up nicely to dovetail towards a Mazda speed iteration, because it's similar to what the Germans have done. It's moving the everyday stuff to a more everyday place and making space for the performance versions to really shine in those ways. So I think there's a good strategy here at Mazda. You probably heard me say before that Mazda and Porsche seem to be the last two companies left that are really caring about how the thing is engineered and how it drives, with exceptions here and there from others, and exceptions within their own stable when it comes to Porsche. Mazda doesn't really make the exception, though. It's kind of solid from bottom to top. You know, criticize them for certain traits all you want, but I think a lot of those traits come from the desire to put driving in front of everything else. A lot of people say, oh, it's too cramped, oh, it's too noisy, oh, it's too this, oh, it's too that, but thematically, they've always been focused on driving above all. And I think they've, as I was talking to Dave Coleman about during the LA show, I think they've come to a point now where they've reached a really nice balance. I mean, the reason I chose this car is I wanted to come up here and smoke through these mountains and then have dinner in Nashville, which is another couple hours, and then drive another 6-7 hours to St. Louis, Missouri, where I have family. And, you know, that takes a really broad breadth of capability to build a car that appeals to someone who knows cars like I do, and I decide I want to spend the day in this car, not only on roads like these, but on a long freeway slot. I like good damping, I like small wheels, I like tall sidewalls. I'm old school like that, but that's something about Mazda I'm starting to notice, is that I think they're old school like that. They're getting to the point where they're looking back in their back catalog from those Amanti days, but also the back catalogs of other great car makers, and realizing, you know, at some point we deviated from a really masterful balance between handling and comfort, composure and refinement. Now I'll simmer down since I have someone ahead of me, but I hope that helps to translate some of what Mazda is doing with their cars and why driving matters and feel alive is a terrible, terrible turn in their marketing. Driving still matters at Mazda. It continues to matter. It will always matter. Let's hope that they're rewarded for their efforts and that the marketing will once again align with the zoom zoom nature or driving matters nature of these cars. I'll do everything I can, and I suggest you raise your voices as well. This company deserves so much more than it's been getting. Let me know what you think if you've driven one of these. Look forward to hearing from you.
So the last thing I wanted to do here is just show you what I mean by these. There they are. The auto high beams kick in about 25 miles an hour. And on this stretch of road, we're not going to have any oncoming traffic, unfortunately. And at this time of hour, it's hard to imagine on what stretch of road nearby I'll be able to find any oncoming traffic. But as you can see, the way they bend and lead your eye, there's a deer, perfect example, lead your eye to where your eye should be going. In this case, Mr. Deer, right in front of me. Perfect timing, buddy. Thank you. Yeah, love these things. I think Mazda's done a great job with them. Both on this car, the CX-5, and the MX-5 RF I had in the European market, totally charmed. I think it makes us all better drivers, safer drivers. if anyone scoffs at automatic high beams, please just reason with them or slap them in the face, because they have no idea what they're talking about. Active front lighting, it's a good thing. Don't resist it. Just like automatic wipers, automatic climate control, all these things are blessings, not curses. Just learn how to use them and why they're there, and you'll feel the same way. And there's another deer.